I've been wanting to talk about bad autism research for a while now, and I never quite had the energy to tackle it. But I came across this headline recently from the website SciTech Daily, which covers, you know, tech and science articles. A drug that cures autism? Neuroscience study yields promising results. And this is obviously a really inflammatory headline for the autistic community and probably neutral or positive to everyone else. And this headline just thinks, wow, these scientists are really so smart. Amazing what they can do with neuroscience these days. But what if I told you that the actual research they did was on mice and lab-grown neurons in a petri dish? I smell a rat. Welcome back to my channel. My name is Sam and I talk about autism and sometimes ADHD here. I'm not usually a mouse, but today I am, because today I want to talk about...
the mouse model of autism.
Yes, it is a thing. I can't believe I even have to make this video. It's an actual thing. Now, my undergraduate degree was in psychology, and a lot of what I got from that degree was the ability to read and understand scientific papers, and also understand a bit how everything works in the world of scientific research. I now get to call them out on their BS. Now, I'm going to get back to this specific research paper in a bit, but it's really important to note that the mouse model of autism, it's a thing, it's a real thing. These researchers didn't make it up, they just probably didn't think too critically about it. If you go to Google Scholar, which is a really great starting point for amateur science sleuthing, you can find over 17,000 studies if you search the term autism mouse model, and that's just since 2019. Also, there are other animal models of autism out there, believe it or not. I'm not going to talk about them in this video because I just can't, and also, I don't have the costumes. So this is a thing. It started in the early 2000s, and you know that phrase, standing on the shoulders of giants? When talking about science, you know that every bit of research is building on the body of research that exists before it, and you're just, you know, like, taking it that little bit extra up. And this is more like standing on a giant pile of turds. The basic concept of the mouse model of autism is that autism is genetic. So they genetically modify mice in the genes that they've found to be linked to autism in people until they show so-called autistic behaviours. And then they find ways to stop those behaviours. And then we celebrate because we've just cured autism. Oh my god, the jokes write themselves, don't they? I don't even have to try, really, with this one, but I'm gonna go through it anyway. I'm going to dissect this. Dissect? I hadn't even written that one down. Now, it's really important to note that there is no one gene for autism. It's extremely complicated genetically and involves many factors, including genes being turned on or off or activated. And even if they poured funding into looking for the autism genes, which many researchers are trying to do, I don't even think that they would find anything straightforward enough to act on in a kind of gene editing way. I understand why people are concerned about this kind of research with regards to eugenics and the potential for autism testing during pregnancy, which has the potential to be a thing. People really hate autism. I do believe, ever the eternal optimist, that the neurodiversity movement will get there first. Before it's even possible to accurately screen for autism in utero, the problem that I can see is, despite the lack of accuracy, that people are gonna try anyway. But just to give you an idea, over 1,000 genes have been reported to be associated with autism. And that means that they found a link, but that's not necessarily a causal link. So they don't really know that the gene causes the autism, but they found a link anyway, so they get very excited about all this kind of stuff, don't they? So typical autism mouse research, I'm struggling to say this with a straight face continually through the video, but the typical autism mouse research, I still can't do it, sorry. They'll typically target one of these genes, right? They'll activate it somehow, and they'll look for an increase in behaviors associated with autism in humans. Translate that to how they think mice would show autistic behaviors, and voila, with enough genetic fucking around, they have created an autistic mouse. They don't even know how and whether these genes contribute to autism, but they sure want to find out. This is ridiculous enough as it is, but I want to make sure that we're all on the same page here. So, mice don't have autism. Mice are not people. Even if we could accurately look at one of the genes that contributes to autism in humans, are we absolutely sure it's going to do the same thing in mice? And are we actually saying that if we just activate enough genes, we can give mice autism? Because all I can see in the research is that they've messed with a bunch of mice, looked out for a bunch of autism-associated behaviours, of which there are many, and they could pretty much pick any behaviour a mouse does under stress and say, look, they're being more autistic. These researchers sure know how to squeak by with questionable methods. Now, there's a concept called scientific validity that I want to address here. Scientific validity is the concept of ensuring that the measurements taken in a research study actually measure what they are intended to measure. It's the basic foundation of good science. It's important to ensure that your results are not due to chance or any other factors, and that the study is conducted in a way that is reliable and trustworthy. Poor scientific validity can include things like using a small sample size, of which there are a lot of those when we do people autism. Autism research in people often have very, very small sample sizes. Not controlling for confounding variables, using flawed statistical analyses, or not properly blinding the researchers or participants to the study conditions. And blinding in this context means that you don't know which group you're in, or you don't know which group your participants are in. It can also include using animal models that are not representative of the human condition, or extrapolating results from animal studies to humans without sufficient evidence. So, are these mouse autism studies scientifically valid? Well, no. I found a very interesting study which actually talks about all the different genes that they mess with mice in order to make them more autistic, and the so-called autistic characteristics they display once the little mouse has been messed with in that particular way, with that particular gene. Some examples of these observed behaviours from different genetic mutations include low sociability, impaired nest-building behaviour, reduced ultrasonic vocalizations, reduced preference for social novelty, increased repetitive self-grooming — that sounds a little bit like what I had to do to get my hair looking so nice today — repetitive stereotyped circling patterns, high levels of repetitive motor stereotypes, stimmy mice. These are just a few that I picked out to give you an idea of the kind of things that they look for in autistic mice. Speaking of stereotypes, I feel like these researchers have never met an actual autistic person outside of the DSM that they quickly read in a panic before doing this research, and maybe never even a real person. I can't even fathom how impaired nest building in mice relates to autism in people, unless it's a dig at my inability to keep my house tidy or whatever, in which case that really hurts. But these studies get published in science journals, pretty well-regarded ones as well. The whole model has somehow gained legitimacy, and I'm but a lowly YouTuber further delegitimizing myself by wearing mouse ears for your entertainment while making extremely valid points. Should I take them off though? I didn't actually think this through. What if somebody sends them this? That's too late now. The funny thing is, they talk about low sociability in these poor autistic mice, because obviously autistic people hate everybody and are not very social. But it turns out mice are not social creatures in the first place. Even the director of a mouse behavioral facility at Columbia University says, in the wild, male mice are highly solitary and may come into contact only with a mate and its pups. Let me sit next to you. What's going on? That's not necessarily what mice do. And it turns out mice aren't even as social as most rats, let alone being as social as humans. If you're studying a social deficit disorder — lots of quote marks there — but if you consider yourself to be studying a social deficit disorder, wouldn't you pick a test subject that's like a little bit comparable to humans, at least in terms of sociability? So why is this a thing? How has this become a thing? You might be thinking, it's so ridiculous. How did anyone just make this up? And I believe that there are many factors that have contributed to this model, this ridiculous model, gaining legitimacy. Pressure from academic institutions — you might recognize the term publish or perish, which means that researchers are incentivized in the sort of throughout their career to basically churn out content to further their career, much like YouTubers. There are also many institutions, you know, actively working towards a cure for autism, who are funding research. There are many companies that would probably love to sell lots of extra supplements if it was shown to decrease autisticness. Not to mention drug companies throwing money at research to find a use for a drug that they've already developed and don't know what to do with but want to sell more of. Or people wanting to promote a diet or a therapy or something else in the attempts to justify their existence. So that's many reasons and lots of money involved. Follow the money. So let's take a look back at the study that I mentioned earlier. It's very high profile, it's very recent, it's got a great clickbaity headline. The author of this article is the German Cancer Research Center, which also contributed to this research. So we know that whoever wrote the article knows what they're talking about. Probably understands the research, we hope. A lot of time, science journalists will read a press release of a study rather than reading the full study because science can be hard to understand, and they're busy people, journalists. Very helpfully, they actually summarize the study in the first sentence. In a new study, a drug that blocks sodium channels was shown to curb autism-associated behaviors such as hyperactivity in mice. Hyperactivity. You know, autism isn't the first thing I would think of here, but okay. ADHD mice are next. Don't even. But just like the other mouse research, they are looking at genetic alterations or mutations, which they switch on, which are then thought to contribute to autism. And so this study is basically thinking, is there a way to switch off the effects of this particular mutation? As they put it, scientists are intensively searching for the molecular abnormalities that contribute to this complex developmental disorder. So they want to switch these genes on and off. The way they do that is with the mutant autistic mice. And also, human nerve cells that had been derived from the reprogrammed stem cells in the laboratory. Okay, we're not going to talk about that. We're just going to talk about the mice. Squeak. They actually did manage to get the mice to show these autism-typical, apparently, behavioral changes, such as social deficits and hyperactivity. And the thing is, the thing that I want to mention here, I'm not just here to crap all over somebody's paper. A mouse would, an autistic mouse probably would. They managed to block sodium channels and they managed to show an alteration in behavior, reverting back to before the gene was switched on. That's great. That may actually be of value to psychiatry or neuroscience. That in itself is quite interesting. It could give us something new and interesting about the brain and how the brain works. It's not necessarily, I say not necessarily, completely pointless research. The problem I have is while they're doing this thing is they're like, hey, maybe we can fix autism while we're here. Subject number 4736 just won't stop categorizing his cheeses. But I'm not completely condemning the whole research. If you look at who was involved, it was the Hector Institute for Translational Brain Research, HITBR, is a joint institution established by the Central Institute of Mental Health, in German that is ZIZ, the German Cancer Research Center, deconstructing, and the Hector Foundation too, II. The aim of HITBR is to identify new molecular and functional targets for the therapy of severe psychiatric diseases and brain tumors. That actually sounds good. Like, let's do that research. Let's target the severe psychiatric diseases and brain tumors, please. Is there just more funding for autism or something? That they had to have a thinly veiled excuse to do what actually might be interesting research? I don't know. I don't know why they brought autism into this. It seems like there's a lot of interesting, applicable kind of like reasons for doing this outside of, oh, we're, these mouse are a little bit hyperactive. Let's squash that.
Let's kill their joy.
Sorry, I'm getting a bit worked up now. This paper is luckily open access. It's free to look at if you'd like to look for curiosity's sake. You know, curiosity killed the mouse. I'll link it below with the rest of the references. But my honest opinion is that this research just simply isn't very good. Oh, the Dutch people are like, I don't get it. Gouder? I don't get it. The research is not very good. So please let me know below if you liked this look at bad autism research. And if you have any studies you've read that you just think WTF and would like me to ridicule further, I'm totally up for that. It was really fun to make this one. Huge apologies if any of the jokes in this video were a little too cheesy. See you next time. Squeak! What's this? This is obsessive grooming. It's an autistic behavior, don't you know? Cut. I am not usually a map. Also, there are other autism... No. It started in the early 2000s, you know, the golden age of... Oh, crap. What am I talking about? That was not the script. Stop ad-libbing. Before it's even possible to screen for people... Screen for people in utero. Social deference.